My name is Tomas Palermo from Google Play, and welcome to YouTube Presents Ziggy Marley. David Ziggy Marley is Bob Marley's oldest son and five-time Grammy winner, author, musician, human rights advocate, and in 2011, he released Wild and Free, his fourth solo album, and it was also nominated for a 2011 Grammy Award. He's also released several albums with his siblings as the Melody Makers, and in 2009, he was invited to the White House to play the annual Easter egg roll. Ziggy is also the executive producer of the new documentary film Marley, released on April 20th, on demand and in theaters everywhere. Please welcome Ziggy Marley.
Hey, what's up? Thank you.
So Ziggy, your new album, Wild and Free, explores more of a roots reggae sound. Mm. Tell me about what you want to accomplish musically on this new album.
Musically, we just want to keep it simple and record something that we could do live and it would come across live well. And that has proven itself. We've been touring and, you know, the songs from the album really connect live well with the people, and that's what I wanted to do.
And for this album, you recorded it partially at your studio and also worked with Don Was, who's produced everyone from B-52s to Bob Dylan. How is it working with Don Was?
Don is an old friend. You know, we know Don for a long time now. We did Spirit of Music with him, with my brothers and sisters. And then I did the album, the children's album, Family Time, which we also won a Grammy for Best Children's Album. And then, you know, he's just a good person. He's a good person, really. And that's how I like working with good people who are good human beings. That's the first thing should be on your resume. I'm a good human being. If that's the first thing, then we're good.
And also you worked with Heavy D on one of his last recordings before he passed. Yes. He, of course, helped popularize dancehall lyrics for an American audience and all them kind of things.
True.
What was it like working with Heavy D?
Well, it's not really working with Heavy D. Heavy D is a friend. So when we get together, we don't consider it work. We just consider it play. Yeah. You know, so it was good playing with Heavy D, having fun with Heavy D, you know, and it's such a good human spirit, you know, really happy, lively, positive all the time. Just a good energy. It's just a great energy, you know.
So the title of the album, Wild and Free, you want to explain that for us?
Wild and Free. Yeah, I mean, it mean wild and free. It mean organic. It mean non-GMO. You know, it mean using nature, you know, for balance, the pollution. You know, it mean using herb, you know, marijuana. Using all of nature, really. Mm. It represents everything in nature, including marijuana, as a plant that can be utilized. I mean, you hear people giggle, right, when I say that, right?
Sure.
But that's the first response, is the giggle.
Yeah.
But then let me get a little deeper with it, because it's not about the giggle, you know. Mm-hmm. It's really about the plant have so much other uses than the giggle. You know what I'm saying? The hemp side of this plant has so much potential to help the planet and the people here. The seeds are very nutritious. The fibers of the plant can be used for all different type of things, building material, clothing, all different things. I mean, paper. You have paper in your hand. That paper came from, like, some tree pulp. Mm-hmm. Now, why we have to cut down all these trees when we know that trees are a significant part of our environment, which help us to breathe oxygen? If we use hemp, it's much more sustainable than cutting down trees and using the pulp. You know, so that is the bigger issue. Get past the giggle and get to the bigger, the more wider perspective of the plant, you know.
True, and you write some about this in the comic book or a book that you put out, MarijuanaMan, and trying to explain it on all those different levels, correct?
Yeah, it's important. It's important to forget the whole truth, not just part of the truth, you know.
Well, one song from Wild and Free that I really love is the song Forward to Love.
Yeah.
Tell me about that song. What's that expressing?
Well, it's expressing a universal love on an individual level. You know what I'm saying? It's coming from the perspective of an individual relationship, but it's love is always bigger than individual relationships, you know. So it really kind of urging everyone to let's move forward to love, as the song title says, forward to love. Let's go.
Yeah. It's a very uplifting, positive kind of feeling in the song there. Your son Daniel is also on the album.
Yeah.
How is it recording with your son? It kind of comes full circle, the whole family vibes. Yeah.
Yeah, man. Nice. He's an aspiring musician, so you know, forgive him the experience of working with me and you know being in the studio and you know being under my my directive on my album. It's a good experience for him as an aspiring musician. Yeah.
How old is he now?
I'm about what 21, 22 right now. Yeah.
Good. And what's been the proudest moment of your music career so far to date?
Well, the proudest moment is fulfilling the dream that my father had to be independent. A few years ago, I think it was after my first solo album, we decided to just stay clear of record companies and do this thing ourselves. And this was this is what I heard growing up in my house forever. You know, it was like, independence, freedom, rights. And so I think, you know, I really feel good that we were able to accomplish that, you know, because again, that was my father's biggest dreams, you know, was to be, have that freedom from being under contract with labels, you know.
You've done a lot of humanitarian work too over the years. You started an organization called U.R.G.E.
Yeah.
Tell us about some of your projects, what they do, and how you're involved.
Our projects really focus on children. And I mean, we're a very small organization. And, you know, we're not out there, like, soliciting a lot of money from people because we like the things ourselves, you know, and if people feel the will to give, they can give. But it's children, especially in Jamaica, where I am from, you know, poverty and all of these things. And we just believe that education is a way forward. You know, we have to get the next generation ready to uplift themselves out of the situation that they're in. And so we focus on educating. And right now we adopted a school in Jamaica where we're trying to improve the learning environment, improving the educational standards of the kids there.
Mm. Now you've got a tour coming up, culminating with a date at the Hollywood Bowl in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And that's your Legends of Reggae show.
Yeah.
You're also doing a radio show by that name, too?
Yeah.
Tell us about Ziggy Marley, the DJ.
Well, it's something that has been in me to do. And the idea is for me to pay respect to the legends, you know. Of reggae, because a lot of times the lesser known musicians or artists are not highlighted, you know. I'm not comfortable with that. My father is the biggest name, right? And everybody know Bob Marley, but growing up, you know, this come from how I was brought up and being around my father. Everybody was equal. All musicians get respect. You know what I say? So this is what I want. I want to pay respect to all the musicians within the reggae. And also, it's a way for me to make sure the next generation of musicians in reggae in Jamaica don't forget the history of the music. Don't forget those who came before us. Because sometimes the hype of today's music business or pop world, people can forget the history. Without the history, we wouldn't be here without those who came before us. So it's a way for pay respect to everyone, the least known and the most well known.
The radio show is once a month on Sirius.
Yeah. First Saturday every month on Sirius XM satellite radio.
And then the concert's gonna be July 19th or so.
I don't know.
Anyway. July in Los Angeles. July, at the sometime, Hollywood Bowl. Yeah. Right. Okay. As I mentioned in the introduction, you're also the executive producer of the new film about your father.
Yeah.
And it's a documentary about his life. And I wanted to ask you, what do you think the film teaches us about his mission?
About his mission? I mean, it, it's a kind of overview of Bob's life, you know. But I don't think the film isn't really about his mission. You will learn about his mission. You will learn a lot of specific details. What the film is about is creating an emotional connection, you know, like I have with him. But now this film will give other people that opportunity to have that sort of close emotional connection to Bob, and hopefully that will help them to better understand his music and where it's coming from and his message. And when they listen to it, they will listen from a new perspective, a deeper perspective of who Bob was. So I think that is the purpose, to create a more deeper relationship with the audience, you know, to Bob, you know.
Yeah, I definitely felt that, especially in some of the archival footage and the amazing live concert photo, you know, images that were in the film. We have a bunch of questions here that were sent into your Facebook page and also your Twitter.
All right.
And we have audience out here that wants to ask some questions too. So I'm going to pull up this question from Twitter, actually. Polano Pasta wants to know, is your favorite memory of your father in the movie?
No, I don't think so. Because my favorite memory of my father was in a dream. So the dream wasn't in the movie. So.
What was the moment that you recalled in the dream?
Private.
I hear that. And then from Facebook, Zachary Steven Sanson wants to know, what did your father's life inspire you to do or achieve in your life?
I think my father's life, and, you know, I have to say that a lot of time we talk about my father, in terms of his influence on me, but my mother also played a big part. It wasn't, you know, it's really both of them that inspired me. And what I saw from them was hard work and purpose, and that music became a tool to enlighten people, to bring things to awareness, to express reality, and to bring people together because of that common experiences that we have as human beings. So, and them teach me spirituality too. You know, we grew up in a church, we grew up in a culture of Rastafari, very deep spiritual things, and both my mother and father really instill that spiritual thing and charity and these ideas in us.
Another question posted to your Facebook page was from Debbie Julian, and she says, how come you never seem to look any older? I've been a fan for over 20 years. I got old and you didn't. What's your secret for you?
No secret. No, well, I think if people take care of themselves, eat the right food, keep healthy, exercise, keep positive attitude, you know, then life, the youthfulness of life remains. The spirit is a spirit make you young. You know, it's a spirit that make you really young. So, but what goes into your body and trying to keep healthy by exercise is very important. We call our body the temple. You know, it's like your house. You want to live in a dirty house with stuff all over. Keep your house clean, you know. Put things in your body that will help your body to be sustained, you know. Organic stuff and stuff, less chemical, less drugs, natural things, you know. So that's what I would say, but, you know, that's what I do, you know.
Very good. Well, I want to open it up to the audience and see if there's any questions from the audience that we can ask to Ziggy Marley about his music or about the film Marley, which opens Friday in theaters and on demand, right there.
How old were you when you wrote your first song, and what was it about? He asks,
how old were you when you wrote your first song?
Let me see. My first idea, maybe about 13, maybe. It was about a girl. Yeah, it was about a girl and her eyes. And I think my father laughed at it.
Yeah. I'm going to go to another question here from the Facebook page. Alvin Fleming wrote, has growing up as the son of Bob Marley altered the ways others act towards you? Has it made life easier or harder?
I think we experience both sides of it. I mean, going to school. No, our culture. When I went to school for a little bit in Delaware, and that was a culture shock for both me and the other kids there, because I had my hair was very long. Because they didn't used to cut my hair when I was younger. You know, that's mm-hmm. part of our culture. Mm-hmm. And so when I went to that school there, it was difficult for the kids to relate to me, and I think that made it hard. Also, even within high school, I think people had a preconceived notion of how they think I would have probably be. But, you know, I never make anybody take advantage of me. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, them, you know, they don't know. You know, they didn't know that we could stand up. You know what I'm saying?
Things,
you know, these kids might be a little softer or whatever, but
yeah.
we dispelled that very quickly. You know, that those are the hard stuff. I think everybody got through that though as kids growing up in school. There's always something like that. But the easy thing is later on, you know, people really love Bob. So when them say, oh, this is Bob, sons or whatever, children, then people automatically feel some affection of love towards you because what, you know, your father had done or is doing. So I think there's both sides to it, a good balance, you know.
Cool. Well, I think we're here to gathered here to hear you play some songs and do some music. So
yeah.
Let's bring up your collaborator, Takeshi Akimoto, and let's hear Ziggy Marley do some music now, yeah?
Yeah.